There's something about love that makes people not only feel comfortable, but want to be with you. And that was the underlying success of our show.
The scene between you and Barney sitting on the front porch. I mean, you know, really, all you had to do was sit there and rock. You wouldn't need. You remember? And apparently, this scene which you're about to see precedes. Barney has been replaced. You've left Mayberry. You've been replaced, and you're a nervous wreck going back. You're not sure how this new deputy is going to receive you. You don't even know if you want to meet him. Turns out the guy is Barney Fife is his idol. So quite understandably, Barney's thrilled with that. And here he is. He didn't know whether to get his car fixed or not, and he told Goober to fix it, not fix it. But here's Don Knotts at work in probably the best character portrayal in the history of situation comedy. Is that an overstatement? Watch this.
Say, Goob. Oh, Barney. I was just going to call you. I put my other work aside and got that fuel pump on again for you, knowing you was in a hurry. You ain't. Take it off. Well, yeah, a new one would be better, but... Well, okay.
You like it? The show was in black and white in 1960, was it not?
Mm-hmm.
For a couple years, and then?
Five years
black and white. What's different, Jim? Did you notice anything different about the industry now? Was it technically less fun to do the movie?
Friends? Oh, no. The movie was... the thing that thrilled me about it was it's an old Andy Griffith script. It's like time has stood still, except for us getting older. Yeah. Other than that, Mayberry's still the same, and everybody's still the same. It's wonderful. It's a great script.
I thought things got a little more bureaucratic since 1960, though, where that maybe the setups take a little longer and you don't. I bet you guys did a lot of your work with one take. Wrong? Maybe not.
We did quite a bit one take.
Yeah, quite a few. Quite a few with one take. We know the characters so well. And these two friends of ours, Harvey Bullock and Everett Greenbaum, wrote this script. And I'd been on it for a long time, so... I usually try to learn my whole part before I start anyway. So, it's fast. If you want to do it again, you better say I want to do it again fast because the camera will be gone.
Gone, yeah. Yeah. Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry. Let me get back to you. Yes.
I was wondering when are we going to see this new movie?
Heather, glad you asked. April.
It's on Sunday night, April the 13th, on NBC.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, I just wanted to say I grew up with Opie and Aunt Bee and the rest of you, and I think you're all terrific. They don't make shows like they used to, and it's good to see you back.
Thank you.
We're in New York City with a gang from Mayberry, and we'll be back in just a moment. Is Thelma Lou in this? In the rerun, in the movie?
Oh, absolutely.
Good. You never did marry her, did you?
Should I tell? I marry her in this movie.
Well.
And Jim Nabors sings, Gomer sings at the wedding. It was up.
Yeah.
No, it was really neat. We got up, we shot up at a little place called Los Olivos, beautiful little tiny town. And it's in the San Ynez Valley. We had a community chorus as our choir. And it was really neat, really neat.
I was going to ask Jim Nabors if he ever sang on the original Mayberry RFD on television. I don't remember.
Well, Mayberry RFD was the follow-on, was the program that extended...
The Andy Griffith Show.
The Andy Griffith Show. Yeah, that's all right.
Yes, as a matter of fact, I did. I think it was where Don and I, Don wanted to sing the solo, and he sang off so bad that he sang terrible. And they heard me changing a tire, and I was changing a tire out by the church one day, and I was singing. And so they decided they wanted me instead of Don, which brought on the whole conflict in the story. So.
Yes, ma'am. Who'd I see?
Andy, I have been in love with you since No Time for Sergeants. And I want to know if you've thought about doing a romantic comedy, and if you had, who would you like as your star? You are beautiful.
He's really blessed. Yeah,
well, he is blessed.
Got ready.
That is the first time I ever saw you blush.
Well, to answer the question, thank you. I have to level with you. I don't do that kind of stuff well. We tried to, first of all, Andy had a girlfriend in the beginning. Eleanor Donahue played it, and it just didn't work out. It wasn't her fault. It was really mine. And then she left the show, and we brought in different girls trying to establish. And it never worked. How we finally got a relationship, we didn't have to go through that courtship. Because that's the... when you put a Kodak on me doing that courtship, it's just silly. So what we had was Opie's teacher. And we became kind of friends, and finally we were even married on the show. But... the most we ever talked about is what we were going to take on the picnic.
George, you've been on Broadway. You're a man who works for a living. What'd you do on the boards?
I did a show at the Winter Garden called All American years ago. Mel Brooks wrote it, and Joshua Logan directed it, and it starred Ray Bolger.
Really?
And but I gotta tell you, playing Goober, you don't have to be that smart. I asked Andy one time, I said, tell me about Goober. And he said, Goober's the kind of guy that would go into a restaurant and say, hey, this is great salt. I said, that...
Yeah.
I'd like to compliment you on what you've done for television and the memories you've given us to grow up with. But I'd also like to know where you're originally from.
All of us?
Sure.
I was born in a town called Mount Airy, North Carolina. And I went to school at Chapel Hill and taught school in Goldsboro, and I have a home now on Roanoke Island, North Carolina.
And your heels are painted with tar, I'm sure.
Tar Heel. I'm a Tar Heel born, Tar Heel bred. When I die, Tar Heel dead.
How about you, Don? You're a West Virginia.
I'm from Morgantown, West Virginia.
Mm-hmm. Jim?
Is that it?
Yeah. I don't talk a lot.
Yeah. That's all you got to say, huh? Yeah. I'm from...
Try and control him, will you? He's a pushy.
I'm from Sylacauga, Alabama. And I used to work in this town. I was never an actor here. I worked for the United Nations, and I was a typist.
Look how thrilled George is with that idea.
No, as a matter of fact, I was the fastest typist at the UN. And Seriously? And so they only paid $55 a week, so I got real skinny here. I look like one of those care things, yeah. Those posters.
Yes.
I weighed 126 pounds, you know, and I'm 6'2".
Wow.
And so people really felt sorry for me. But anyway, I was the time working about at the United Nations. I used to talk like Gomer, and exactly, pretty much. And
you mean routinely?
Yeah.
Golly, Mr. Ambassador, how you doing?
No, as a matter of fact, I was working in this office over at the UN, and I used to answer the phone, and they tried out four languages on me before they realized I was speaking English. I just thought I'd use up Don's time.
George?
Well, I'm from Jasper, Alabama, and go there on Thursdays because that's the day it's open. And I came to New York here to study acting at the American Theater Wing, and I lost my accent and couldn't get a job. And I got it back, and I've worked ever since.
You know, it surprises me that we haven't exploited the small town locale more than, you know, since here. I'm not saying that we've not seen any drama or even, so there's been some comedy ideas from there, but it's such a successful vehicle. We love the people.
Yes.
I remember watching Don Knotts on the Steve Allen show as...
nervous.
Yeah, the man on the street.
Mr. Who? What was his name? Can you tell us?
I don't remember.
It wasn't Gordon Hathaway.
No.
What was your name?
You think you got me?
Yeah. Do you have any idea how grateful I am that Don Knotts isn't here alone? My God. Yeah.
He doesn't remember.
Yeah. I'm not sure he had a name. I'm not sure he had
really have a name.
He didn't identify himself in the comedy sketch with Alan. You know, it's true, Don. You have never... You're not a talkative guy, and I admire you for not pressing. I mean, you don't try to be something you're not. You must.
Funny.
He's funny. Yes, he's funny.
He's funny.
But I have seen talk show hosts grow thin interviewing this guy.
Well, you know, I know I'm a...
Wait a minute. Hold it. He's going to talk. Go ahead, Dad. Go ahead. You were going to say...
I know I'm with people who like to talk.
That's
and
true.
In that case, I like to listen.
Yes.
Phil.
Yeah, George.
Phil, I would just think, Jasper is open every day, because my Aunt Ethel still lives there, and they can kill me.
His Aunt Ethel's still
there.
It's
a wonderful town.
Yes.
I love you all. This is fantastic. But Mr. Griffith, I tell you, I love you as a comedian, but I have seen you on TV where you played some roles where you're the man I love to hate. You can be a mean SOB when you want to be.
Yeah. Thank you.
That's right. our business is a funny business. And when I left our old show after 8 years, I had been very successful, and I couldn't get a job because the kind of stuff that I did had been doing was out of fashion then. And in order to survive, I started playing heavies. And at first, I couldn't really get the parts. And now I'm known as one of the best heavies. heavies are kind of fun to play. They're sometimes hard, sometimes not too bad.
I played the killer once.
You did play the killer.
Yeah. I did.
Yeah.
I think the hardest part that I ever played is coming out, I guess sometime next month. I played, the name of the show is called Not Far From the Tree. And
not
I played it, Not Far
tree.
From the Tree.
Tree.
I played an alcoholic.
As in the apple falls, not far
right.
from the tree.
Right, that's it. I played an alcoholic father.
Yeah.
And it is indeed the most difficult role I have ever attempted.
Is it about endangering your own child with alcoholism?
Yes.
Yeah.
It shows the defensive lives that these four people took as adults, as they grew.
Yeah. You live in North Carolina, don't you?
I mean, I live in North Carolina and in California.
Yeah. Guess what? Tomorrow is the union, the big high school reunion.
Oh.
Andy and Barney's high school reunion. They're all coming in tomorrow. This is the night before, and Andy and Barney are sitting on the front porch.
Union High, victory is yours, well nigh. We'll hit the line, 4 points every time. The orange and blue will try. And when the victory's won, you'll be our favorite son. Proud waves your banner in the sky. Mayberry Union High.
Do you have any idea how much nerve that takes?
But right. You probably can keep a tune.
Oh, yes.
And so he's able to do that on purpose, isn't he?
Oh, yes. Yes.
I don't know how you kept up, though.
Don has a wonderful musical ear. And
tell us about Andy, will you?
Well,
I actually do.
He does. He's a good tenor. I'll tell you something one time.
Yeah.
One time, there is a nightclub up in Lake Tahoe called Harris.
Yeah.
And Don and I were booked in there. And we were supposed to have a girl go with us. I forget who it was. And our manager, Jim and I used to have the same manager. He talked them into taking Jim. Now, nobody knew then that Jim could sing. So we're out on the stage, and Don had done some stuff, and I had done some stuff, and so Jim comes out in that gas station uniform with that silly cap. And I said, "Well, Gomer, now that you're here, what would you like to do?" He says, "I don't know." I says, "You want to tell a joke?" He says, "I don't know no joke." I said, you want to dance?" He says, "No, I can't do that." I said, "Well, you want to sing?" He says, "Okay, I'll sing." I said, "What do you want to sing?" He said, "I want to sing Vestula Gerber from Il Paul Yacher." I said, "Okay, here is Vestula Gerber from Il Paul Yacher." And the band hit, and that man started to sing, and the audience went, "Ooh!" And then later, he only had 14 minutes of material at the time. Remember? He'd just been in the business a minute. So when he did us 14 minutes, I came back out on the stage and the audience booed me. And I threatened him. I said, "We got enough of us up here, we can take you. Come on up." I said, "Jim will be back in a minute." And later in the show, the three of us sang in three-part harmony with a chorus behind us, a beautiful arrangement of Down in the Valley. And the audience really couldn't get over it. We don't remember.
You know, you could sell a lot of tickets, the three of you. There's no doubt about that. I mean, I don't know. You know, you probably don't need it, but we thought, really, I think you all could pack them in.
Or I need it.
We haven't established your singing voice. That's the only difference. We're in New York City with the gang from Mayberry, North Carolina. We'll be back in a moment. Yes, ma'am.
Will Aunt Bee be a part of the reunion?
Unfortunately, her name is Frances Bavier, and she isn't well. So she is not in the show, but she's the only one.
She's the only one that didn't.
She's the only one.
Yeah.
We have her voice at one point.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I was wondering, was it your first job, and were there lots of auditions when you first started up?
Yeah. You guys, now you did what it was football. You remember that record?
You see? I thought, sure, sooner or later it would happen.
Now, these old boys just marched up and down this field. Didn't you remember that record? He's explaining
that
football.
That piece of material is older than Opie. And yes, it's the first thing I ever did. Yeah.
But her point is, you were unknowns before this sitcom.
I wasn't.
That's right, you weren't.
No, Don.
That's right, you were
Don,
on Steve Allen.
Don was known.
And you were known.
I was known. I had done two plays and three movies. And one of the plays was a play called No Time for Sergeant.
I was in.
Don was in that.
Barely.
I wanted to know, originally you had to play the part that was written for you. Did they eventually start writing the part to fit your personalities? Because you did it so well, like Don Knotts. You seem quiet here, but you played so well, and it seemed like that was the real you. Did they make the parts to be your personalities?
Well, I think the writers and the actors, when you develop a character in a situation comedy, it sort of evolves. The character evolves between the actor and the writer.
The writer writes after watching you work. He writes to you.
Right.
What happened in our case is the other ingredient that I didn't mention before that made the show successful. In the beginning, we were spun off the Danny Thomas show, and we had the aunt character, my character, and the little boy's character. That's all we had. And I was to have a thick accent and tell funny stories. And had we gone that way, the show would have lasted about a minute. Don called me, and I didn't know he was free, but he called me and said he'd like to be in the show. And I said, oh, call Sheldon Leonard right away. He did, and the second episode we did,
I know the scene. Was it the one where he's learning to be a deputy and memorizing the...
No, that's a different... the second show we did was a show called Manhunt. It became obvious in that show that Barney should be the comic and Andy should be the straight man. And the second show. And so then we added other comic characters, such as these two fine gentlemen here, and Floyd the Barber, and all those.
Floyd is deceased.
Deceased.
We are sad to say. Yes.
Having a teenage daughter whose favorite show today really is the Bill Cosby show, I'm so pleased that there seems to be a trend toward more wholesome family entertainment. And I wonder, will this movie be possibly a pilot for a new series?
You mean answers?
You got it.
I'll try that one. As a matter of fact, Andy had a show on last week, which was a marvelous show called the Matlock, Diary of a Perfect Murder. And
thank you.
And I think, is it okay? That's
sure.
A pilot for NBC. And then I'm doing a pilot, a situation comedy pilot for NBC, too.
George?
What they're saying, it's a pilot for me.
Yes.
I think the thing that made your show so great was that you didn't rely on fads, sex, violence. You relied on things that happen in everyday life, and it's relevant even today. And I think that's why it's still so popular.
Well, at the risk of putting maybe too much sociology on this, the primetime schedule really is a reflection of our culture. Truly is. If you wanted to know who we were, watch what we were watching in 1957, 67, 7, so on. I wonder if we're trying to recapture our lost innocence. Is that a possibility? I don't know. George, you're the philosopher.
No, I was going to say that the one thing I think people don't realize, our wardrobe is not a date. We can still wear that stuff.
That's true.
I just wanted to ask each one of you, did you plan on being actors when you were young? Was this something that you wanted to do?
I did. I planned it from the very beginning.
I just didn't want to work. I just didn't want
to. They love it when you talk, Don.
Anybody as good looking as Don, it's a natural.
Don Barney returns to Mayberry, and of course, where did you go in the script? You go to Raleigh, or you went to Big Town, did you?
Mm-hmm.
So you're coming back to see some of the old folks, old friends, and you're going to stay at Andy's place.
Mm-hmm.
They got a room for you. Golly, or not you, golly, isn't it?
Yeah.
But you're just very grateful, and here's a scene from an old Andy Griffith show.
Here's your nightlight, Barney.
I hope you didn't put that in just for me. I mean, I can take them or leave.
We thought we'd just put one in.
They like. Yes, ma'am.
I grew up in a small town in West Virginia, and the lifestyle, they didn't even open it up maybe once a month. But the lifestyle was so true to life in this small southern town.
Yes.
I could identify with it.
Yes. Yes.
Don, I was just wondering if you've got anything going on now.
Me?
You.
Well, I'm doing a commercial in Miami tomorrow.
Yes. Yes, sir.
Yes, there was something about that Mayberry that just had this storybook type quality about it that I think everybody could identify with. Is Mayberry really a place, or is it just like a state of mind?
It's a state of mind. it isn't a place. I'm sure there must be a town called Mayberry somewhere, but not in North Carolina. And it was just, I don't know, as I said early in the show, the backbone of our show was love. And I think that more than anything else made it successful.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my father's from Winston-Salem, and I grew up watching your show. I'm just wondering, what years were they on? I can't recall.
60 to 68. True?
Mm-hmm. She's not from Winston-Salem.
No, my father.
Her father. Oh, I see. Yes, yes, she used to work at the UN.
Yeah. I was kind of young when Mayberry was on, but I love Three's Company. I want to know, Mr. Frehley was my favorite character on the show, and how did you find playing the part? Because it was fantastic.
How did I enjoy it?
Did you? What, John?
Oh, I enjoyed it very much. I didn't enjoy it as much as Barney, but it was a fun character because Three's Company was a farce comedy, and they we just played everything broad and full out. Yeah. Lots of prop falls.
Yeah.
I have family in Lancaster, South Carolina. It's a little town. And when I was about five, we moved to Minnesota. But when I would watch Mayberry RFD, I remember sitting on the porch, especially on Sunday afternoon, and making ice cream. And there's a couple of times where you do that in Mayberry.
Couple of times. You had some, remember the citizen's arrest?
Oh, yes.
Citizens arrest. Citizens arrest. Gomer arrests Barney. You have never seen the outrage like this.
That's my favorite.
That is a very... Those were brilliant ideas.
I was just wondering if Ron Howard had any input into the direction of the film.
You mean this one?
Yeah, the return film.
As a matter of fact, he didn't attempt any input. Bob Sweeney directed the show, and Bob Sweeney directed the first 3 years of our old show. Ronnie, I know his name is Ron, but I've called him Ronnie as long as I can remember. And Bob Sweeney called him Ronnie, and before we were finished, the entire crew and company called him Ronnie.
Yeah.
It's okay with him.
And we'll be back in just a moment.
Mr. Nabors went from the UN typing to acting.
You know, you weren't at Schwab's. You got...
No, I was at a place called The Horn, and Andy saw me work there one night, and...
Here in the city?
No, in Los Angeles.
I see.
Yeah, I was living out there, and I sang. My act consisted of singing like this and talking like this, and that was the extent of my act, and He was very nice, and said if a part ever came up on his show that he would call me, and he did.
Yes. I think you've all had pretty successful careers just from the Mayberry program itself. Is there one role or one part somewhere in TV land or movie land that you'd like to have that you haven't so far?
Yes, George.
I'd like to play Gandhi. But the cap, you know.
In this movie, how many years have elapsed since the last show in this reunion?
Yeah.
19. We've rounded it out at 20. We referred to 20 years ago a lot.
Here are Andy and Barney seeing each other for the first time after all these years.
Busy.
Ah,
go to the
dance,
all right?
You look great.
Yeah, I really think so.
Yeah, you look just like always.
Oh, I work out. Living there in Hawaii, Raleigh, you know, I had all the equipment right there.
Yeah.
Relax, the pecs.
Yeah.
Pecs and the lats.
Yeah.
I got the body of a boy.
You son of a gun. Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, it's okay. It's such a bursitis.
Yeah, a lot of boys get that.
Uh-huh. Bursitis is bad.
Did you hear that laugh? Yeah.
I was just wondering if you could tell us what's happened to Opie in these past 20 years. What has he turned out to be?
He's turned out to be a very successful film producer. Very successful.
He's also the editor of the paper in Mayberry.
Yeah. I've got two questions. The first one, hopefully, will be a little serious. You mentioned how Ronnie was the name. Is there any anecdote or what was the magic between you and he in the selection of him? And on a less serious note, if I may, while I have the mic, many of the ladies around here have been saying how marvelous your hair all looks. And obviously, I'm very interested in that also. Do you have any secrets on how you stay so young, hair-wise?
Very nice. I had nothing to do with the choice of Ronnie. Sheldon Leonard did that. There are a lot of things that make that boy up. I think first would be his parents. He has incredible parents. And he's got wonderful genes himself. He is a fine human being. It was wonderful to see him again and to have to work with him and have the visits. And so far as hair is concerned, my father had a lot of hair. Don, if you notice, wears a cap.
Don, this may surprise you, but not everybody who does that on our show gets that kind of hand.
Yeah. I always loved Goober and Gomer, but I remember Mayberry RFD, I loved it, or Andy Griffith, but I cannot remember, how did Gomer come in? He was your cousin, right?
No, I came in.
No, I mean Goober came in as your cousin.
Yeah, I replaced him when he went to the Marine Corps, and we both auditioned for the role, and he got it.
Yes, yes, ma'am.
You all work so well together. Are you personal friends? You see each other?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes, yes, ma'am. Yeah.
In addition to the success that the Andy Griffith Show has brought you, do you ever feel you've been typecast because of your roles?
I don't think so.
Was the movie all done in Hollywood, or did you go on location?
We went on location.
Where was that?
Did you go to North Carolina?
Little town called Los Olivos.
Oh, in California.
Yes, we built our sheriff's, the jail, the sheriff's, that whole corner we built.
Will old Doc Harvey appear on the show?
Say again?
Will old Doc Harvey appear on the show?
Old Doc Harvey.
Doc Harvey was just a man, he's a man I know in North Carolina, and we just referred to him, no.
How about Otis?
Otis?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That's the biggest change that we have. I didn't do this, the writers did it. I first suggested we eliminate that character. And they didn't do that. They sobered him up, and he's now sells ice cream. It's a good idea.
Oh, it is a good idea. And it's interesting. Was that cute? The guy locked himself up every Saturday. Remember,
right.
He smashed?
Right.
I'm not sure that would get by standards and practices today. You know, alcoholism is not funny.
No, and I...
Now you listen, I'll tell you, the phones are ringing and the kids are banging themselves up. It's pretty rough out there, so I don't think you can get away with a comedic drunk anymore.
That's the reason I said, let's eliminate the character. But our two writer friends said, let's have everybody, let's give him a position. So he's sober and he drives the ice cream truck. And I think it's a good idea. Wear the white suit.
Yeah.
Without giving away too much of the movie, you said Opie was the editor of the newspaper. Is he still a son, or is he married now with family in the
newspaper? He's married. His wife has a child.
In the play, in the script, this is, you're talking about.
In the script. He's married. His wife has a child in the show. And Ronnie himself is married and has three children.
Here are you and Ronnie at work. Talk about good old days. You are telling him that he has a son?
Yes.
You know it because you were there for the birth of the baby, and he obviously is arriving late.
No. What happened was we're in my car, and my car gets as far as the G&G garage.
Yeah.
And she has the child in the back seat of the car, and Andy...
With Goober and Gomer attending?
No, Andy. Goober. Andy delivers the
Andy delivers
the child. And the scene is with the boy and Goober and Gomer.
All right, this scene is following the delivery, you'll be pleased to know. We don't... we're not at hand for the delivery, but we are, as Andy tells Opie,
yeah,
about his fatherhood. Roll the tape.
Paul, is Eunice all right?
She's fine. She's a little tired, but she's fine. So is the little fella.
little fella?
Your son.
My son. My son.
Jim Nabors, are you nightclub singing at the moment, and where?
I don't have another one till I think last week of May. I'm at Harrah's in Reno.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
I think that people really, when they start watching a show every week, want the characters to be as nice off the screen as they are on, or as close to the characters that they love on screen, which I think is part of the problem of some shows. They're really nasty. You do terrible things when they're not playing. Other programs, and I grew up watching the show, and it's wonderful. And there are towns like that. My in-laws are in them.
Yes, there are.
Thank you.
I think they're all nice as off-screen as they were on-screen.
They seem to be, don't they? I'm impressed, too, that you've all kept working. I mean, that's the only way to do it. There are some folks, you know, who really hit it big in a series and then I think had a difficult time adjusting to life after a series. That's such a regular job. And then suddenly to have it behind you, it's a different sort of...
I quit for a while. I farm.
Oh, yeah. Yes. You know, this is Aloha Kid here. He owns half of
Maui.
I do
not.
No, but you do have some... Well, it's been well publicized. You're a rancher in Hawaii.
Yeah, I raise macadamia nuts.
Mm-hmm. Yes, uh-huh. Sure. He's a multinational corporation, this man. Yes, yes, ma'am. Hi.
Whose idea was it to reunite all of you? And how long did it take to get the show on the air? And did you have trouble getting into the role again?
Was it hard to jump back in the skin of the old character? Take your time, Don.
Why me? I like to make faces. No, I didn't find it too difficult. Although I had been doing Mr. Furley for a long time, and he was pretty loud, boisterous, and broad. So I had to pull it down and sort of remember. But it didn't take long.
And the idea shouldn't surprise us because of the frequency of reruns and the fact that they're successful. All of the reruns that have been attempted have worked. You want to see them. Hi.
Hi.
You had a question?
Yes. I wanted to elaborate on what you said. When the show went into reruns, did you, any of you, find it hard to find work or have any pressures as other actors do when their big success goes into reruns?
I got a job on Hee Haw right after. I had a very difficult time, as I said earlier. And that I started playing heavies, and then but I missed the comedy. Yeah.
I just wanted to ask Don Knox if he was married or had a family.
Are you married, Don?
Yes and no.
Well, that's clear, and we'll be back in just a moment. Return to Mayberry airs on NBC April 13th, yes.
I just wanted to ask if they're all fathers.
Yeah. You're all fathers.
I'm not.
No.
I am.
I am.
Yes.
Is the show more popular now with the reruns or when it was first in film?
I think more people watch it now. I really do.
With you said your show is based on love, and the new shows seem to be based on sex and violence. What do you think of the TV's influence on children today?
See, hard services provided and promotional fees paid by the following.